Hi, I'm Ugo, and you're watching Barrow TV Extra.
Hi, I'm Macarone Massimo. You're watching Boro TV Extra.
TV.
You're watching Boro TV Extra.
TV.
Nail it.
McLaren began season 2002-2003 well aware that the second year in the hot seat is often far tougher than the first, but Mac was ready for the challenge. After coming through his baptism in management by establishing the club in a respectable 12th place, he was ready to serve up for the Riverside faithful some wonderful attacking football and to try to move Boro up to the next level. On home territory, Mac was ready to attack and bring the entertainment back. The story of Steve McLaren's second term begins with a hectic close season as the manager worked tirelessly to bring new faces to the club. Frank Cadre eagerly accepted the chance to make his loan spell into a permanent transfer as Boro paid loans £2.5 million for his services, but with the defence finalised, focus turned to the midfield and to the attack. Massimo Macaroni arrived as one of the rising young talents in Europe. The price paid to Empoli of £8.15 million was a club record, for the 22-year-old had already won his first cap for Italy and had been the jewel in the crown of their under-21 side that had defeated England in the European Championships. A gamble possibly, but the young striker was clearly a player with huge potential. In the midfield, George Boateng was signed as the natural successor to Paul Ince, and the Dutch international would prove to be a wise acquisition. McLaren then moved quickly as Jeremy's permanent transfer to Chelsea from Real Madrid stalled, and the boss brought the Cameroon international on a short-term contract. Jeremy had been capped more than 50 times for his country and scored a terrific free kick against England before the World Cup. Jeremy was ready to make the Premiership sit up and take notice. The final piece in the manager's summer spending spree was perhaps the most dramatic of all, as the fans' number one player of all time, Juninho, returned for his third spell at the Riverside. This time, he was a World Cup winner, and Teesside was ready to go samba crazy all over again.
Jeremy delivers the cross and it comes through and the ball is in the net, and would you believe it?
Everything now seemed set for success, but sadly, in the final build-up game in Italy, tragedy was to strike as Juninho suffered the agony of a cruciate ligament injury that would condemn him to an operation and months of painful rehabilitation work. The samba star was back, but he wouldn't shine at the Riverside for some time, and the pain went to the heart of Boro supporters everywhere. Nevertheless, the season was all set to start, and the players' focus turned immediately to the task of trying on a hot August afternoon to bring back something from the long trip to Southampton.
Schwarzer tries to release Carlos Marinelli away quickly, and Marinelli's ball forward is on to Macaroni. This is a great early chance for Boro. And Massimo Macaroni nearly capped his full Boro debut in the Premiership with a glorious goal.
A point represented a satisfactory start on the travels, but now for the opening game at the Riverside, and enter the Gladiator.
Stop down now for Boro to Greening. Greening with a first time ball looking for Macaroni. Macaroni will try and watch that. Macaroni! Oh! Bellissimo! Massimo Macaroni in his home debut in the Premiership.
capitalised on the mistake by Andy Melville, the Fulham captain, and it's 1-0.
It's a terrific finish, would you say? It's a mistake. It's a mistake by Melville. Uses his body strength, Magaroni. What a sweet strike, bringing the ball into the back of the net.
Marinelli now for Borough. Plays the ball inside, and it was Jonathan Greening who just came in front of Massimo Macaroni. Greening's cross, and Macaroni's header! And that is Borough's second, and it's Massimo Macaroni again. And Steve McLaren's investment is paying off. Boa Morte has Previtt in support. Previtt's cross, it comes across the face of the goal, and it's been put in the back of the net. And Fulham have scored. And Fulham now will try and look for something. It was Saha and away in the end. And there's another chance, and that's an equaliser. And would you believe it, the substitute Saba has pulled one back for Fulham.
Two games and 2 points. But what the manager wanted was a win. And the visit of Blackburn Rovers would provide the opportunity for a player who seemed to have lost his way to prove he could still do a job.
Jonathan Greening to Gareth Southgate. Southgate knocks the ball long. Johansson it was that missed it, and Jeremy's clear. It's Jeremy across the face of the goal, and Joseph Job! Joseph Job, the substitute, has done this week what Fulham did to us last week. And the referee is coming across to talk to his assistant and talk to the players, but it's a goal and Borough are ahead.
With the first win of the season secured, it was an unbeaten Borough that arrived at Old Trafford. But Steve McLaren was to find out, as so many visiting managers had before, that a game against United can turn on the decision of the man in the middle.
Phil Neville puts the ball in now. Scholes just tried to take it through to Van Nistelrooy on the back hill. Beckham to Giggs. Giggs first time, Van Nistelrooy! Oh. And it's a penalty kick. Here we just see it go over the top again. Van Nistelrooy against Schwarzer. Yeah! No mistake, 1-0.
He's lost up on that one. One thing about Van Nistelrooy, he does give it a hell of a thump when he takes the penalties. And there's a keeper in the world could have got anywhere near that one, right in the roof of the net.
Jobber just tried to turn his man. It's Macaroni now. Nemeth went on the run ahead, but it's still Macaroni. He shoots. Goalkeeper spells it. Nemeth has had the goal. Jeremy and Kedru standing over it. Ehiog looking for it. Flow back. It's Kedru that delivers. Macaroni. Chance for Borough to counter-attack with Massimo Macaroni. It was just one against one, it's now two against two, and Macaroni's ball. And Macaroni played a great ball into Szilard Nemeth. And that's three! Szilard Nemeth has his second, and Borough at their third. And what a brilliant counter-attack.
Well, it's that old link-up again. But it's all due to this pass. Macaroni have done magnificent. Picks his man out, inch perfect pass. And what about that for a finish into the far corner?
The Riverside euphoria would still be felt at Goodison Park 4 days later, but David Moyes was having a growing influence on rebuilding the Blues, and Borough would get their first taste of Wonder Boy Wayne Rooney on an afternoon that would turn sour.
It's all just a little bit scrappy at the moment. Possession given away, Jeremy plays the ball forward, flag has stayed down, and Macaroni is through on goal. It's Macaroni, he shoots, the ball's come across, and Nemeth! And Borough have scored through Szilard Nemeth, his third goal of the season. Disappointing from Paul Gerrard's point of view not to get a stronger hand on that, perhaps?
Well, yeah, I would have thought that he could have collected that. He seemed to fumble at it. Anything in the air. The Everton team are actually...
The goal is in there by Kevin Campbell. It's Campbell's second, and Everton are ahead, just as we were saying. Middlesbrough have lost their influential captain, Gareth Southgate, the rock at the heart of the defence, and Everton have really taken advantage of it, haven't they?
Tony Vidmar had been added to the Borough squad, and the Australian international was ready for his debut against Birmingham City. But this was an afternoon that would belong to Frank Cadreux. Cadreux started the season with a two-match ban, and disciplinary problems and Frank would sadly go hand in hand as the season developed. Nevertheless, on his day, Frank could give Borough an extra dimension, and his free kicks, well, let the pictures do the talking.
What a goal! Fantastic, Frank!
Absolutely.
Frank Cadreux, he did it once last season, and he's done it again today. Frank Cadreux opened the scoring for Borough.
Absolute blinder. We've seen him take free kicks before, and this one's come off. What do you say? Balls in and around the area, gets you a free kick, and he does that.
Brilliant. Here we get to see it again.
Yeah, tremendous. I was going to say Jeremy was going to take it because he was going to float one in the other way, but the only option was to shoot, and he spent it right into the top left-hand corner. Brilliant. Absolutely superb goal.
Well, the fans here love French Frank, as they call him. They're certainly going to love him some more this afternoon. It's Frank Cadreux that's opened the scoring.
Steve McLaren stated at the start of the season that the campaign was all about setting higher standards, and the best illustration of the type of football the manager wants to see was set on a warm afternoon in North London as Borough soared to third place on the back of their best performance in over 25 years. Centre-forward Massimo Maccheroni added to his growing reputation with Borough's opener in a one-sided first half. And into the second period, Borough underlined their class as Cameroon international Jeremy scored his first goal in a red shirt. The visiting supporters could hardly believe it as a ragged Spurs were brushed aside with arrogance, Massimo Maccheroni providing Job with a chance to make it three. Borough was simply that good. The capital was also the destination for Borough's opening round of the Worthington Cup. Wholesale changes were made for the trip to Brentford, as stars of the future and players on the fringe of the first team were given their chance to make their mark. Marinelli then turned provider, as the tie was effectively all over by half-time, as Noel Whelan rounded off the Argentinians' brilliant build-up play. The second half could be enjoyed by the travelling supporters, as Mark Wilson curled a beautiful shot into the top corner of the net for Borough's third goal on the night. And just before the end, Stuart Downing showed his delight at being part of the first team with a splendid finish, and the Borough boy enjoyed his celebrations with his supporters. The late goal from the Bees could hardly spoil the party, as Borough progressed comfortably into the third round of the competition. Back-to-back games in London had produced 7 goals, 3 points and a cup win. The season was clearly well on track. 10 games into the season and Bolton Wanderers came to the Riverside Stadium. It was the final Premiership game before England's European Championship qualifiers against Slovakia and Macedonia. Sadly, Hugo Ayoub, despite a string of fine performances for his club, wouldn't find favour with his country, but the popular central defender was ready to take out any pain he might have felt on the Wanderers.
Cross comes in now, maybe a chance, it's in the back of the net! It's Hugo Ayoub who scored the goal, and Jussi Jaskalainen couldn't keep it out. And that's the start that Borough have been threatening ever since kick-off.
Yeah, great volley from Jeremy with his right foot. He's lost his mark in the box. Hugo had a good contact on the ball and finished beautifully.
In the end, it's Maccheroni who launches it. And Job it was that rose highest and won that header. Bots it's an intelligent play. Flag has stayed down. And the flag has stayed down, and it's Jeremy now. And he has both teams apart, and it's 2-0. All the time in the world for Jeremy. He was composed. I thought he might just try and dribble it in. Great goal, though.
Ladies and gentlemen, there
I think he might be putting this one into one of the players maybe on the edge of the box. He does just puts it over the wall and the header, and it's in the back of the net, and Mark Schwarzer is beaten. And Jason Yule it is that's opened the scoring for Charlton Athletic, his second goal of the season. That's bounced to Greening, who hits it. Jonathan Greening, oh, he was a tremendous strike and a great save, didn't Kylie?
Great save.
Stuart Parnaby is one of the bright young stars at the club and was given his Premiership debut against Leeds United. But whilst it was an afternoon to remember for one fullback, it would bring only late despair for the other, as Frank Cadreux would see red.
Parnaby just tried to lay it off with his chest. The shot maybe now will come in from Viduka. That's going to be a penalty kick. It's a penalty kick. And now maybe Mark Viduka, as the boos ring round the riverside, has a chance to put Leeds United in an early lead. It's Viduka against Schwarzer. Oh, and he just puts it beside Mark Schwarzer. Maybe a chance now for Jeremy. It's Jeremy's through and goal, and Joseph that's the equaliser. Joseph Job with his third goal for Borough this season. And that's really what Borough have been threatening to do all game, isn't it? Lucic's making forward run now. He's found Kjell. Kjell's found Viduka, and Kjell continued his run as well. This is a good chance. Great save, Mark Schwarzer. And Lee Bowyer has put the ball in the back of the net.
That's why it's difficult for anyone to break them down.
Near post comes Schwarzer. Captain, he hasn't scored yet for Borough this season. In fact, in interviews he joked that he's got his goal of the season in pre-season. And now a chance for Leeds United to come away with the ball. And that looks like it's going to be a
sending off.
Another yellow card for Frank Kenroux. And Kenroux is off. It's his second bookable offence, Frank Kenroux. And both teams down to 10 men now.
From a Yorkshire derby to a Tyne Tees derby, and Borough would leave St James's Park feeling that the key decisions hadn't gone their way.
Macaroni then on the edge of the box for Middlesbrough. Ross comes in from Jeremy. Good header away by Hughes. Macaroni goes down under pressure. Few appeals for penalty, but not given. And maybe another opportunity for them now as the ball comes in. Amiobi it is. He finds a bit of space and shoots. And Shola Amiobi has put Newcastle United ahead. Maybe an opportunity now for Borough to do something. It's with Macaroni. Macaroni shoots. It's hit the post. Oh, he was the woodwork away from equalising, Massimo Macaroni. And that's the first real effort in this second half, and how close Borough were to getting the equaliser. Schwartz has lost it, and this time the ball is in the back of the net. And it's the young central defender, Stephen Caldwell, who's added the second. And it's going to be a red card for Frank Kenroux in his second successive game. And Jack Charlton, you said he needed to watch himself. And Borough down to 10 men, two down, and it's all gone wrong.
The start of November was hectic for the Borough, and sandwiched in between Monday disappointment at Newcastle and a Saturday date with Liverpool was a Worthington Cup tie at Ipswich. As in round two at Brentford, Steve McLaren gives squad players their chance and handed a debut to the teenage starlet Andrew Davis. Unfortunately, Borough never got out of the blocks at Portman Road, and the first half was all one-way traffic towards Mark Crosley in the Borough goal. The tie was effectively settled in the opening 45 minutes, and the second period, frankly, was little better. Frank Cadreux did have the final word, but it was too little, too late, and the route to Cardiff in the Worthington Cup was over for this season. There was no time to dwell on cup heartache, as Liverpool arrived at the Riverside Stadium defending an unbeaten record in the Premiership. But this was to be a red-letter day for the captain.
Disappointing cross. Nemeth plants the ball back in and the goalkeeper comes and he drills it. And the ball has ended up in the back of the net. And Gareth Southgate, I think it is, has put the ball in the net. And I think it's possibly been disallowed. Well, I think the referee is possibly coming over to speak to his assistant.
Oh,
he's given it. Here the goalkeeper came, he lost it. And Gareth Southgate, who at this point in proceedings, I should point out, was 50-1 to be the first goal scorer, has put the ball in the back of the net.
Next for a resurgent Borough was a trip to Stamford Bridge. But as so often in recent years, games against Chelsea would bring only heartache.
Good Janssen again, and he's found Zola. Zola, another great move, has found Babiaro in a bit of space. Babiaro through on Schwarzer.
Alan Boxage had suffered a disjointed season so far, with injuries and a lack of goals. But against the veteran Peter Schmeichel, this was to be Boxage's and Borough's day.
Greening or Jeremy to be the one to deliver it. It's Jeremy that takes it. And it's a goal! Jeremy will have a second opportunity to deliver it. Goes to the back. Alan Boxage with his first goal of the season, and it's two for Borough. Well, Alan Boxage has been desperate to score. You see how much it means to him and how much it means to the 30-odd thousand here at the Riverside. Yeah, what a great ball.
It was a great ball. If you look at the replay, he's not being marked. A very, very bad marking in the box by Man City, and he's on his own and he's picked a spot like Ekiog did.
Horlock, I thought he was sizing up for a shot. Ball goes over the head of everyone and Greening will have to do the defending now. Well, he tried to keep the ball from going out for a corner and I think he nearly put his teammates back in trouble, Jonathan Greening. Might just sit down now for Manchester City. Goethe on the turn and Nelka! Oh, and it's eventually gone over the line. To Greening and now Macaroni had that goal disallowed a couple of moments ago. Now maybe Macaroni turns inside, shoots, it's cleared off the line by Janssen. Maybe Jeremy now. Jeremy hits it and smacks it out. Well, the persistence paid off, didn't it, for Middlesbrough in the end?
Yeah, I think that's, they've actually pinned Manchester City down in their own half and they've had a couple of chances, so they deserve that one.
Clearly this was turning into a season to relish for fans at the Riverside, with 6 wins and 2 draws. But on the travels there were problems that 90 minutes at the Hawthorns illustrated perfectly. For the despair in the Midlands, it was something of a relief to look forward to back-to-back home games. And first was the arrival of relegation-haunted West Ham United.
Opportunity though for West Ham now on the attack with Joe Cole. And Cole's shot! And oh, Joe Cole has scored the goal for West Ham United. And it's disastrous at the start of this second half. We were talking about Middlesbrough lifting their fans. But West Ham United have gone up the other end and lifted their own fans, and well, here we get to see it again, Jamie. Still barking instructions to his players as Borough go on. It was a great back heel from Boxage. This is Nemeth. Nemeth has equalised! Well, look at the delay on Zilla Nimmer's face. It was a fantastic move from Middlesbrough. And the substitute, Zillard Nemeth, who came off the bench at half-time, has scored the equaliser for Middlesbrough. And we were just saying that there was signs Borough were coming back into this one. And well, that's the perfect way to continue this game.
Oh, that's brilliant. I mean, it's a great opportunity now to go on and win the game.
And the ball has come through now to Defoe's in a little bit of space against Southgate, and Defoe shoots, and well, could you believe it, it's Ian Pearce who's scored the second goal for West Ham United.
From a football point of view, Middlesbrough have been brilliant, you know, at times.
Cross comes in, and that's the equaliser, and this will go with Young again. Well, he spoke on Borough TV about his goal celebration that he was going to do next, and well, he popped up with an equaliser against Leeds United. He scored against Manchester City a couple of weeks ago, and he scored the second one here at the Riverside, and West Ham have been ahead twice, and Borough pulled back twice, and that's a vital goal, isn't it?
Yeah, great character. I mean, it's a great corner, and he comes in there, competes, puts the, you know, gets a good header on it, and there. But unfortunately, because it's gone in the back of the net.
By December, Jeremy had already established himself as a firm favourite amongst the Borough supporters, and his reputation as a player of genuine quality was underlined by a moment of magic against Chelsea.
And he's in my dream team, so if he scores, I'll be doubly happy.
I know, I haven't had a bet on him today, though, so... well, I'll take it if the ball goes into the back of the net. In fact, it's Jeremy that takes it, and Jeremy! What a goal from Jeremy! I bet you wish you'd put him in your dream team now.
I've got him in my dream team as well. Don't worry about that. What a strike.
Well, what a strike. What a goal. And Carlo Cudicini. Well, nowhere near. Here we see it again. Look at that.
And I was spot on about Frank taking this free kick there, wasn't I?
Well, that's why we have the experts.
Yeah.
What a free kick that was.
Maybe Cudicini thought it was going to be Frank Wedge hitting it as well, but that's terrific skill from Jeremy.
John Terry forward. Gallas is the only man really back for Chelsea at the moment. Cross comes in now, and it's come through a load of players, and it's been put in the back of the net by John Terry. We talked about how this was a vital moment, vital 5 minutes. And John Terry it is that scored the equaliser for Chelsea. Both teams ball forward to Nemeth. Parnaby's joined the attack, and now Jeremy as well. Parnaby's continued his run. This is Nemeth, who's just had to turn into Boxic. And Nemeth, his flag is up. Well, Nemeth put the ball in the back of the net.
Well, I'd like to see that one again. That looked very, very tight.
Well, the flag was up. It would have been the perfect time, just on the hour. There's the ball, he's onside, isn't he?
Nowhere near offside. That's great play again, as they did last week. Terrifically timed run by Nemeth. Great 1-2 with Boxic. And the lineman's got it completely wrong.
Well, that should have been Borough's second goal.
The halfway point of the season came at Highbury, with Borough travelling to North London in ninth place in the table and with 26 points. But the 90 minutes would bring a pre-Christmas triple blow of injury to George Boateng, a red card for Luke Wiltshire, and defeat.
Well, going to be another booking now. This time it was a challenge by Luke Wiltshire. And here we'll get to see this one again. He'll be filling that one over his Christmas dinner. What a Christmas it is. Really looking forward to the Christmas on Borough TV. Chelsea last week, Arsenal this week, Manchester United on Boxing Day. Top three teams. Can't ask more than that as the cross comes in now, and it is in the back of the net, and it's Sol Campbell who's opened the scoring right on the stroke of half-time for Arsenal. Well, it was looking ominous, as we said. The goal did seem to be coming. Just a really bad time to concede, really. Let's hope he gets an opportunity on goal. Well, Luke Wiltshire's already been booked.
Surely he can't send him off for that.
Luke Wiltshire's gone. I think Gareth Southgate's trying to have words in mediation. But it's a red card for Luke Wiltshire. Well, his first start in the Premiership this season. He was booked earlier on in the game.
That's not a booking. In my eyes, that isn't a booking. He's enthusiastic, the kid. He wants to, you know, wants to do well. And he's just basically jumped out of the way of the tackle. He hasn't really touched him.
Arsenal fans want another one. You can hear them, but trying to raise their team. Henry's ball. Van Pira's in space. And that is the second goal for Arsenal. And to be fair to them, it has been coming. 13 goals last season. 3 in the Premiership this season. Well, and that's number 4.
The festive fixtures commenced with the arrival of Manchester United on Boxing Day. And in a season of some terrific Riverside displays, this was amongst the best.
Now Kedru goes forward again for Middlesbrough, plays the ball through the middle to Joseph Jove. This is a great move. It's with Jeremy in some space now. Jeremy just touches the ball back. Oh. Blanc it was that came in as I think Joseph Jove was waiting for the ball to come to him to lay off his shot. Maybe another opportunity now as Jonathan Green, he hasn't scored yet this season. Flag has stayed down, Boxic. Oh, saved by the feet of Barthez in the end. Good header, an important header that one from Frank Kedru. And well, he's got away now as well. He combined brilliantly with Greeny and Kedru found some space. Boxic has gone through the middle. Kedru's beaten another man. It's still Frank Kedru. This has got to be Boxic now! Second chance and he's made no mistake, and it was all down to that man Frank Kedru. What a goal, Alan Boxic.
Well, it's amazing. We're just going on about how poorly Alan had played in the first half, and he had. He didn't really get involved in the game at all, everything breaking down. But he finished that one off delightfully. He's getting off at half-time now, because the half-time whistle's just about to blow it the next minute or so. He'll be getting off at half-time, the hero now. But the hero for me was Frank Kedru in the build-up to this goal.
It was headed away by Wes Brown. Jeremy puts the ball back in though now. And maybe a chance for Nemeth. Nemeth's just got ahead of his man, and that's 2! Unbelievable! Zelad Nemeth has scored a second right at the start of the second half. Well, Zelad Nemeth, what a fantastic goal. He never gave up and he went past Laurent Blanc. Well, you'd think they just conceded, judging by that reaction.
This is terrific bit of play. The Nemeth. He does brilliantly here. Controls it, he's back to goal, turns, leaves the defender stranded, and he smashes home that right foot shot. Really was. Oh, yeah, he leaves the Schaefer dead there. You've got to say bad defender, but full marks to Nemeth. He doesn't have whack this one and gives Barthez absolutely no chance. What a fantastic start to the second half on Middlesbrough.
What a performance this has been. Steve McLaren's had exactly the right reaction he would have wanted from his players after the defeat against Arsenal. Ball by Kedru. Maybe there's a chance for 3 now with Boxic. Well, he tried to lob the goalkeeper.
What a pass from Kedru. Fantastic diagonal pass. Alan Boxic gets in between the defenders. Bad defending again by Manchester United. It's a good first touch, but the lob just too much on it. Just over Barthez's bar. Great first touch.
And now Scholes comes forward. Scholes to take on Greening, perhaps. Ball's come out now to Solskjaer. Solskjaer delivers a cross in. And Ryan Giggs has got one back for Manchester United. Joseph Jobe won the header. The flag stayed down, actually. And Jeremy it is that's on the end of this one. Jobe and Macaroni's continued. Massimo Macaroni with the header. Maybe Joseph Jobe for 3. And surely now Middlesbrough have scored 3 and will get the 3 points. It's Joseph Jobe with the goal. And credit to Massimo Macaroni. It was a great knockdown from him that put Joseph Jobe in. And Steve McLaren there is telling his players to keep concentration, keep alert and keep thinking, but what a great goal.
Well, it was a peculiar, everybody thought Massimo Macaroni was in offside position. Jeremy whips a great ball in from the right. Macaroni, very unselfish, knocks it across the goal to Joseph Jobe. And I can't think of a Middlesbrough player today that deserves a goal more than Joseph. 3-1 for my money, game over.
Well, there's 4.5 minutes left. Stranger things have happened, but at the moment, it's Middlesbrough 3, Manchester United 1.
The final game of 2002 came at Villa Park, and in another bout of travel sickness, Borough would leave the Midlands pointless and fail to score for the sixth away game in a row.
Gary's able to take that off Jonathan Greening. Now Angel, touch just let him down, but he has Dion Dublin in the middle. Gareth Barry's come forward as well. It comes to Dublin. And Dublin's able to hook the ball into the back of the net for Aston Villa, and it's an early lead on 10 minutes for the home side. Well, Borough had started brightly and forced the goalkeeper to make a save a few moments ago from Szilard Nemeth. But it's Dion Dublin who scored 7 this season so far, and the former England international scores goal number 8.
It's all come really from a loose ball from Frank Quadro in the midfield to Jonathan Greening, which is misplaced. Pablo Angel's played it in, and Dion Dublin's got in between two defenders. He got a strange contact on the ball, which has just looped it over Mark Swarter. I think quite fortunate. Might have been an OG, actually.
Mark Wilson, I think it was, coming been, back.
Yeah, looked like it.
Stuart Parnaby just needs to be alert here, watching the run of Barry and Samuel. And now Mark Wilson is... Well, Mark Wilson's already been booked in this game. And I think this is going to be a red card.
You are joking. Can you believe that? Can you ever believe that?
A red card for Mark Wilson for the challenge.
He's having a laugh.
Well, the Borough players can't believe the decision. Mark Wilson can't believe the decision. But Middlesbrough are down to 10 men.
The new year opened for Borough at Blackburn Rovers, and in a campaign that had been badly affected by injuries to key players at critical times, Ugwe Yog would suffer the pain of a punctured lung, and needless to say, another game away from the Riverside would bring a defeat.
Blackburn Rovers on the attack again though, and maybe a real opportunity now.
Oh no.
It's on the back of the net, and it's the man that Borough so nearly signed, Dwight York, that scored the goal. Well, it seemed to be coming at the start of this second half. Blackburn Rovers it was that had started brightest of all, and Dwight York has opened the scoring. 13 minutes played in the second half.
The FA Cup had seen Borough denied at the semi-final stage last season, but the third round draw hadn't been kind, and every fan knows what tends to happen when we go head-to-head with Chelsea.
Saw Steve McLaren ahead of this match in the tunnel. He was keeping half an eye on the Manchester United game earlier on today, and he looked in pretty high spirits. Let's hope Chelsea don't dampen them now with Hasselbaink in space for Stanic. Stanic shoots. Well, the goal had been coming, you might say, and Mario Stanic has scored it, his fourth of the season for Chelsea. And just as we were talking about how Steve McLaren would be happy with the scoreline 5 minutes before half time, it's an awful time to concede a goal, and Chelsea have scored it. Jeremy and Kedrua standing over it. There's players forward like Vidmar making runs. Will this be the defining moment of the second half when Borough get the equaliser? Kedrua whips it in. Goalkeeper will need to make a save. Well, send it up in the back of the net. But the referee has come diving in. I think the foul will be given against Dean Windass. And players like Gronkart and the referee are keeping Dean Windass back. It was his challenge on the goalkeeper. And now every player, it seems, far 5 or 6 red shirts in the back of the goal mouth. Here we see it again, Alan.
It's a great ball in. It's the old-fashioned take the goalkeeper as well. It was a foul. Obviously was. The player's reacting a bit sillily, though. As that ball came in, Windass needed to go for it. He knows he's got to take his opportunity. He was a little bit late. Obviously was a free kick. But the Chelsea players have really responded in a way that perhaps is not that necessary. I hope nothing happens that's too serious for Windass. It wasn't worth that. What followed wasn't nice to look at, but the incident didn't necessarily provoke that very thing that followed. That was a lot of other players. The incident, if he is to be booked, I think that perhaps would be the right thing. Let's see what he's going to do here.
Well, every supporter here at Stamford Bridge on their feet and booing Dean Windass, but the Chelsea goalkeeper Carlo Cudicini has been sent off. Unbelievable scenes here at Stamford Bridge as the Chelsea players surround the referee. Well, Claudio Ranieri has a bemused look on his face. I think the red card was expected to go to Dean Windass. It's gone to Carlo Cudicini, the goalkeeper, I presume, for his reaction. And, well, none of us predicted that one. Ball forward, aimed towards Whelan. Ball won't sit down for Noel Whelan. Comes out as far as Jeremy! Yes, oh, it's gone wide. I thought it had bounced into the back of the net. And De Hoy, the substitute goalkeeper, well, he kept his side in it there.
After the high of the Boxing Day win over Manchester United, Borough had now suffered three defeats, so there was a real need to pick up at least a point from the visit of Southampton, and the inspiration for a fight back would come from two substitutes, Macaroni and Whelan.
Fernandes again, the header is on towards Marsden. Marsden tried to cut the ball back to Beattie. And that's goal number 14 for James Beattie. And Southampton have opened the scoring here at the Riverside. Oh, his vest, I think, has obvious written on it.
That's a terrific strike. But again, Marsden's got space over on the left-hand side. How many times have we seen that this afternoon?
In towards Nemeth. Jeremy had made the run forward as well. It's touched back to Nemeth again now. Oh, it's Joseph Job, flag is up. Oh, Joseph Job put the ball in the net. It was such a good move.
It was the best bit of football of the afternoon from Middlesbrough. Really open Southampton up there.
Well, this will be the angle that shows us, Gary. Here's Nemeth.
Oh, well, I'd have to say he's probably just on.
Well, Steve McLaren's side definitely started this half the brightest, but it's Gordon Strachan's team that has come back into it in the last couple of minutes.
Oh,
and possession given away by Vidmar to Beattie, and that's number two for Southampton. Well, it was an awful mistake from Tony Vidmar. He holds his head in his hands at the moment.
We just can't believe what's just happened there, really. I mean, it's just a simple ball. It's went so far adrift, it's quite remarkable.
Wilkshire with a header on towards Macaroni. Macaroni's played the ball forward towards Noel Whelan. Whelan with the shot! Oh, what a goal!
That's fantastic.
He's spotted the keeper off his line.
Listen, you saw him look up. You saw what he was going to do. As soon as he looked up, he's seen the keeper off his line. He's connected with it absolutely perfectly, and it's flew in the back of the net. I mean, that's what he's capable of now. You see him just check the keeper.
Greening finds Wiltshire, and Greening made his run forward then. Wiltshire plays that into Macaroni. Macaroni's just trying to turn. Macaroni in the end finds Kidruin. Maybe Wiltshire in some space. Wiltshire goes down. Is it a penalty? It is. Well, the last time Borough got a penalty kick, it was against Southampton at the Riverside. That was 50-odd games ago. And it's another penalty. Everyone in the Riverside, except the Southampton fans, will try and blow this one into the net. He does it! Massimo Macaroni scored the equaliser for Borough, and Massimo Macaroni is back on the score sheet at the Riverside as well. He's waited a long time for the goal, but now it's come, and Borough right back in this game. Anti Niemi was beaten, dived the wrong way, and that's great for Massimo.
It is, it's got to be great confidence for the lad to get back on the goal sheet.
The terrific Noel Whelan goal should have provided the lift for Borough to conquer the travel sickness at Fulham. But sadly for the travelling army, the script was becoming all too familiar.
Another chance maybe now for Davis if he can just get ahead of Southgate. And Sean Davis has opened the scoring here at Loftus Road with 7 minutes to go to half-time.
It's the last thing Borough wanted, but that was the best bit of play in the whole game. Great move up, back and in for the midfield runner. Good finish.
Deep into January, and Borough still possessed the only unbeaten home record in the top flight. But with captain Gareth Southgate sidelined by flu, it was Borough who were caught cold against the Villa.
Kidru underneath that one and wins it again, but only as far as Vassell. Vassell continues to go, and still to rise Vassell. Three or four players forward for Villa on the edge of the box, and Shot comes in the end and it's gone straight through Mark Schwarzer. And the goal's in and it's 2-0. Borough, of course, would love to get something before the half-time interval. Ball over the top. Maybe Macaroni now! Yes, that is the next goal and it's Massimo Macaroni that scored it. Well, we were talking about how vital the next goal was. Massimo Macaroni pops up, right place, right time.
They're blowing from Jeremy's. Joseph, I think, is actually trying to score there, but it's fell nicely for Massimo.
Now it's Jeremy. This is Parnaby. Into Greening, it's another good move, and Greening might go all the way. Yes! It's the equaliser from Jonathan Greening. His first goal this season in the Premiership. Well, you can see what it means, not just to the players, but to the substitutes as well. And Borough are back on terms. And I can tell you, Sir Bobby Robson is somewhere in the crowd this evening watching this one, with interest, I'm sure. And don't forget Liverpool at Anfield, coming up on Borough TV Extra very shortly as well, as the cross comes in. It's away by Jeremy. Only as far as Hitzlsperger. Well, it might come now to Gareth Barry. Barnaby's having to come across and chase, and it's J. Lloyd Samuel, in fact, who's made the run forward for Villa now, and Samuel's cut the ball right across the face of the goal, and that's number four, and it's Darius Vassell again. Oh, it's another goal, and it's Dion Dublin this time.
After the Aston Villa defeat, there was a real need to inject some new blood into the squad. With the time rapidly running out before the January transfer window closed, the manager had to work quickly. And in a triple swoop, Michael Ricketts, Malcolm Christie and Chris Riggott all put pen to paper for a delighted Steve McLaren.
I always said all along, even in January, that we're always looking to improve our squad. And the same, I know Keith won't like hearing this now, especially with these three sat here, but we're always looking to improve. And come the summer, there'll be no different.
All of the new boys were included in the squad for the game at Anfield, but yet again it was to be a moment of sheer magic from Jeremy that caught the eye and ended a run of eight Premiership games away from home without a goal.
Jeremy, it is, that hits it! Oh! What a goal! Borough ahead at Anfield! Well, Borough have not scored away from home since the 28th of September. They've only scored four away from home all season. But what a way to break the duck!
That is an absolute peach. That is an absolute wonder goal. I tell you what, Dudek, I mean, never in a month of Sundays did he expect that Jeremy could put it in that little corner. Absolute wonderful strike.
This is Owen again now against Stockdale. Owen goes past Stockdale, past Jeremy as well. Well, the ball might sit down for Risa. Well, that's the goal that Liverpool have been threatening for most of this second half. John Arnorisa scored five in the Premiership. He scored against Borough last season and he's got the equaliser here as well. If it is that launches it, ball comes right across. It might come out to Jeremy! Surely Ricketts now! Oh, they've cleared off the line twice and still Michael Ricketts was battling for it. Well, John Hendry, you correctly predicted that Borough would get another good chance in this game. Perhaps that was it.
With a cure for travel sickness now found, a confident Borough made the short journey up the A19 looking for a double over Sunderland. And young central defender Chris Riggott will never forget the game he played himself into the role of Teesside folk hero.
Jeremy to whip this corner in, just saw a glimpse there of the stadium alight. And there's another header and a fine save again, but Borough ahead, and it's Chris Riggott that's done it. Well, Chris Riggott immediately starts repaying that transfer fee. Steve McLaren bought him in on transfer deadline day. He's in the side in place of Ugo Ehiogu, still missing following his rib and lungs injury. And Christian Ringer has put Borough ahead at the Stadium of Light.
Just look at the pace on that ball. It's an in-swinger again, as I told you, and he swings it in with a lot of pace on it. They are very dangerous. A little header into an area, comes off the goalkeeper, makes a good save, and he's walloped it in the back of the net. Now, it didn't surprise me one little bit that Middlesbrough would have taken the lead. They've looked much the better side.
Sit down now for Greeny, who puts the ball back in. This could be Michael Ricketts. It's come off the post and it's in the net. Oh, would you believe it? Christian Ringer scored a second, and Middlesbrough scored a second as well. And this is the dream start for Borough at the Stadium of Light.
They
came off the post.
So much room, so many. Absolutely. There's nothing there it's only bit about. They're blaming the goalkeeper, who had absolutely nothing to do with it.
Here we see it again, Jack.
Just look at the times that somebody might have had a player there and didn't get rid of it. Hit the post, come off it, come out with somebody else. And
Southgate, it was, it hit the post, and Riggott, who put it in the back of the net after
Ricketts. I thought Ricketts should have gone for the header in the first place, but he didn't. He decided to control it and got away with it. But look at him here. This is a great chance.
Southgate there. Riggott with the defensive header. And this is Phillips. Phillips just trying to go himself, and Phillips gets a shot, and Kevin Phillips, we were talking about his goal scoring record.
I was about to say that's the first time that Middlesbrough have allowed Kevin Phillips to turn and run at the goals, and he just showed what he can do if you do that.
Mark Causey, our referee, gave the free kick this time against Kevin Phillips. Well, maybe a chance now for Malcolm Christie. This could be three for Borough. It is, and Middlesbrough right back in front now. Sunderland, having done all the hard work and pulled the game back around, has seen Malcolm Christie score his first goal in a Borough shirt in his second appearance. It's all about the new boys for Steve McLaren. Well, we thought Sunderland were getting back into it.
Yeah.
It's changed it again, hasn't it?
Oh, yeah. Kevin Kilbane, we've got a lot to answer for that little ball he knocked back. I mean, this is... You don't expect it to miss him from there. Goalkeeper doesn't know whether to come and smell the ball, doesn't know whether to stand and stay, and you get no room to knock it past him, no problem. Middlesbrough are very, very lucky for that happened now.
Well,
it happened now, we've put them back two goals in front.
The biggest blow of the season had been losing Juninho to injury just before the campaign began. But the Samba star had worked tirelessly at regaining his fitness, and on an emotional March afternoon at the Riverside, Juninho was ready to announce that he was back.
Maybe Weir gets a vital foot in there. Cleared by Unsworth, and well, the ball was over the head of Stuart Parnamy, and Rosinski has gone away, and he's got away now from Chris Riggott, and Rosinski has some space to attack, and it's behind Kevin Campbell, and Steve Watson it is. And Steve Watson it is that's opened the scoring. Well, he scored four in the Premiership already this season. That's goal number five, and it delights the 3,000 travelling away fans. And really, that goal was all about the work of Tomas Rosinski.
It's Everton that are creating more opportunities now.
He's went past Quedri far too easily there.
Maybe Borough can do something here. It's with George Boateng again. He has Macaroni, and he has Ricketts as well. This is Ricketts. Macaroni in some space now, if he can get it across.
Crucial ligament, you've got to have the total trust in your physio.
The new signings and the return of Janinho had been just the tonic Borough needed to give them a lift, and now for one of those special Riverside nights, as the highest crowd of the season, 34,814, would thrill to taking 3 points off title-chasing Newcastle United.
Macaroni gets the ball out wide to Kedru now. Will this be the cross that leads to the first goal? It's a free header and it's in the back of the net! Borough ahead, and it's Jeremy!
That's the first time Newcastle haven't defended in the correct way. The back four were miles away from the guy that headed the ball.
Well, it was Jeremy,
in the end. Look, you watch here, Jeremy comes in here and there was space. Nobody goes and picks him up at all.
Well, it was Jeremy who just got in ahead of Michael Ricketts there. Both were in the middle. And it's Jeremy that's put the ball in the back of the net. And Borough are ahead at the Riverside.
The games could hardly come quick enough for the Borough, and it was yet another derby, this time destination Elland Road, and a ground that has bitter memories for Janinho, as it was at Leeds in 1997 that he shed tears at Borough's relegation. But that memory was banished in a terrific away day display.
Well, Schwartz will need to conquer it. There's been a mix-up in defence, and it's Leeds United that have taken the lead. And it's Marfa Duca that's opened the scoring, and Borough, that are usually so solid at the back, have capitulated in front of their own goal. This is Boateng, he's urging his teammates forward, he's aimed that one towards Macaroni. If the Italian can get on the end of it, he goes down, and that's going to be a penalty kick. It's a yellow card in the end, and Borough it is that have a penalty kick and a great opportunity now to equalise.
Oh, that was a point of stress this season.
We see it again.
There'll be goals and chances in this, and that all came from the long ball. Macaroni, he's got the legs of Radebe. He's got the pace, and that's a stonewall penalty.
Massimo Macaroni scored a penalty against Southampton at the Riverside this season. He scored one at Elland Road to bring Borough back into this game. It's one apiece after 35 minutes, and Massimo Macaroni, with his seventh goal of his first Premiership season, has put Borough back on terms. And now maybe a last break for Borough. Red shirts getting forward in numbers now. Greening with Murphy outside of him. Macaroni and Christie have gone through the middle. Where will Jonathan Greening aim this one towards? Greening has two white shirts around him. He's picked out Janinho. Janinho with a strike. Oh, what a goal! What a goal! It's Middlesbrough who are 2-1 ahead, and it's the Brazilian with a fantastic strike that's done it, and it's sent the away fans into raptures, and Janinho has done it again. That's why Steve McLaren brought him back for a third spell. What a goal!
Well, we've saw some wonderful strikes this season, but I tell you what, nothing beats that. That is an absolute peach. Just look at it. Paul Robinson never even sniffed it. He just catches it so sweet, and then it's in off the far post. And I tell you what, no keeper in the land would have saved that one. Absolute inch perfect.
Greening has no one outside of him. Boateng's arriving now. Macaroni touches it back to Greening. And now Jeremy looks up, tries the chip. Oh, it's another one. It's number three. And it is a fantastic goal from Jeremy. He's scored seven this season now, and it's another sensational goal from the Cameroon international.
You beauty, that was an absolute peach, and Steve McLaren will be absolutely delighted with that one.
Well, he spotted the goalkeeper off the line. Jeremy only scores great goals. That's top draw.
Well, as the ball came to him here, it's gone in his left foot, and you think he's not going to have a pop with his bad foot, but I tell you what, he's just picked that one out there. Absolute peach.
Well, Steve
McLaren, no chance whatsoever.
Open contract talks with the Cameroon international this week to try and keep him at the club at the end of the season. Will he be adding an extra naught on top of that weekly pay packet on the back of that goal? Eric Bakker has Mills outside of him. Ocon's there as well. It was Mills he picked out in the end. Cross comes in, aimed towards Smith. Smith and Cooper rose together. Cooper did exceptionally well. Still, though, Leeds United chance with Milner. Schwartz has lost it, and this could be number two for Leeds. It's Maduka as well. And with 14 minutes, just over 14 minutes left on the clock, Mark Schwartzer has had his goal breached once again by Mark Maduka.
Eight games to play and the fans had dreams of making a late charge up the table after a run of three wins from four matches. But Charlton would make life difficult at the Riverside and Borough would be grateful for a rescue act from Malcolm Christie.
Real chance for Johansson now. And Johansson has opened the scoring.
Lisby gave a warning earlier on with his pace and it's him who's made the goal. They've caught him on the break, he's had a run at the Charlton defence, and it's to be fair, it's a great little threaded pass through the defence there for Johansson to latch onto.
Jeremy launches it in, it's caught the crossbar! Well, it came off the crossbar in the end, but everyone was expecting it to be launched towards someone. Another opportunity, comes out to Boateng. Now maybe Greening.
A bit slow to react there, the goalkeeper, I thought.
Good free kick. Over on the far hand touchline, picks out Greening. Good cross needed, maybe. Ricketts in the middle, so is Christie. Cooper it is that launches it. Ricketts in the 40 now. Janino! Oh, great save, Kylie. Janino at the second attempt. And a double save from Dean Kylie denies the Brazilian.
Good play there, good build up, good cross. Christie got himself in a terrific position. It's come out, Janino's lashed it. He's hit it too well, really.
Ricketts. Ricketts has picked out Pedro again. Pedro's ball in, and there it is in the back of the net. Malcolm Christie will claim it. It was a good near post cross. And Malcolm Christie has added his second goal in a Borough shirt. A hint maybe that Richard Rufus got a touch as well. But that's the equaliser, and it's all bit deserved for Borough.
Absolutely. The key was, as I said, up to the first half, the fullbacks getting forward. Quedrew's got forward there, got to round about the edge of the box, crossed it in early to the near post, and I said goal before as the ball left his foot, because you could see it was going to get round the back of the defence. There he goes. Christie gets across the front as a good goal scorer would. They're appealing for offside. Can't see it. Good goal. There's there. Good position for a fullback. Once he's bent it round there, Christie's a yard up and he's in. Good goal.
The season now moved into April, and it was time to welcome another Brazilian, as Dorival made his first start in a comfortable win over West Bromwich Albion.
Now, Kedru again. Good ball that from Kedru. Job does really well. Now Christie has a little bit of space as well. Christie tries to turn one, beats two, has the shot, and Malcolm Christie has scored the opening goal of the game. And what a fantastic individual goal it was from Malcolm Christie. His third in a Middlesbrough shirt. Well, that was a top draw goal again, wasn't it?
Absolute wonderful piece of finishing there by Malcolm Christie. I mean, as the ball came into the box, I thought he was going to lay it off for a third time, but he didn't. He thought, this is my chance, this will be my goal. I mean, job done well initially, just to hold the ball up down the wing here. And as the ball came into the box, I mean, wonderful skill, beat two men, and you thought he was going to let off, but what about that? He's just completely wrong-footed Russell Holt in the goal there, and the goalkeeper had no chance whatsoever. Just come back in himself, reverse pass into the bottom corner of the goal net, absolute clinical finishing that is. Wonderful skill, wonderful finishing.
Nice interplay, nice passing, cross does come in towards Job. Job tried the shot, might touch it back to Jeremy. It might still fall for someone now. It's Joseph Job. Holt's had to punch. And Jeremy's put the ball back across. Janino! Well, it hit the crossbar.
Well, there's not many players that could do that. There's not many players who have got that in a locker. But is this just in there? Never in a month of Sundays would you think the wee fella was going to do that. And I tell you what, if that had ended up in the top corner, that certainly would have been goal of the season. Absolute great technique, great ability. Unlucky Janino.
Middlesbrough look to try and find this breakthrough for the second goal. Took them 35 minutes in the first half. Into Macaroni. Janino was looking for the touchback. In the end, it fell for Greening. Greening's gone through the middle. Oh, and Greening has scored the second for Middlesbrough. His second of the season. And that surely has put the game beyond doubt for Middlesbrough now. Well, it's all smiles for Jonathan Greening. Janino has ever had a hand in the goal. And Jono's added the second.
That's an absolute wonderful goal there. Janino just sort of plays a give and go. He's a lucky bounce out to there, but what about that for a touch? And just any stride just smashes into the bottom goal, bottom corner. Goalkeeper had no chance whatsoever. Janino, lovely touch there. Jonathan Greenan just runs on. The pace takes him through, but a wonderful finish. The goalkeeper never even sniffed it.
Well, he doesn't score many goals, Jono, but that was a great one.
Yeah.
Now Deriva. Now Nemeth. Nemeth's gone through now, and there's a chance for the Slovakian, and he's got the pace. Surely Nemeth must make it three. Szilard Nemeth has scored, Middlesbrough's third. And another wonderful individual goal from the Slovakian international. Scored two midweek for his country. Now scored one for his club.
I tell you what, that is a world-class goal. Absolute fantastic goal there. His touch was magnificent. What will give him goal with Janino again. Pace past it. And what about that for composure? You will not see many better goals than that. Absolute fantastic.
It's Szilard Nemeth's sixth goal of the season for Middlesbrough. Remember, in that time he scored three for his country as well. The two midweek and the one against England. But that was... Wow, look at that.
That was absolutely fantastic there.
Borough made their final visit to Main Road before Manchester City moved to their new stadium on April the 12th. And after 90 hard-fought minutes, the unbeaten run would stretch to 8 games. Jeremy picked up an injury against Manchester City that would rule him out for the rest of the season. And his ability to produce some inspiration would be sadly missed against Arsenal.
Borough keeping possession here, it's Cooper. And to that right-hand side, it's Greening, who always makes himself available. Just gets away with that. And Deriva digs in against Parler. Does well. Janino, it's a nice little ball through. A chance for Christie. It bounces off the goalkeeper and Sigan gets it away. And Stuart Taylor has taken a knock there.
Malcolm Christie has got every right to go for that ball. You're a striker, you've got your eyes on goals. And when that ball is played through there, there's only one thing in his mind, and he's thinking of goals.
Once again, Christie is full of running. Well, Nemeth did well to retrieve that situation under pressure from Parler. And there's Deriva running into trouble in the shape of Thierry Henry. Wiltord through the middle, that's where it goes, the first time effort. And Borough are punished for that moment of slackness. Thierry Henry and Pires poised over the ball. It's left to Henry. And it's a terrific effort, and that puts it beyond Borough now. And Arsenal pick up three valuable points in the running for this championship, and just look at the relief more than anything on the face of Arsene Wenger, but a free kick of the highest quality.
The hectic Easter programme left little time to dwell on the defeat by the Gunners, as on Bank Holiday Monday it was destination Upton Park.
Johnson's done well, got past Cooper. This is an opportunity for West Ham. It's come out as far as Sinclair. Well, that's the goal that West Ham United perhaps have deserved. Trevor Sinclair's got 7 in the Premiership. That's goal number 8 for him.
Michael Ricketts' start to life at the Borough had been hit by injury and illness, but he did make the starting 11 at St Andrews. But for the Borough, little went right at Birmingham.
Clements again. Clements is pulled forward. Well, got to be. Christophe Dugarry. Flag stayed down. Clements it is that takes it. Birmingham City have their second goal. Now Devlin. Savage whips the cross in. Oh, and it's a third goal.
Time now. now for the final home game of the season, and what better way to sign off than with a five-star display against Spurs.
Casey Keller, the United States international. Seems a bit sixes and sevens with that one for the moment, as Borough look to break again. Stockdale had some space, but it's into Nemeth. Nemeth's got past his man. Gerard Nemeth, oh, great save, and Christie has opened the scoring for Middlesbrough. Well, credit to Gerard Nemeth, who did spectacularly well, but it's Malcolm Christie who's got the goal. It's Christie's fourth goal for Middlesbrough since signing from Derby County. Really, we talked about a spark, that's the breakthrough.
That's just what we needed. I mean, we've had a let-off, we've had two let-offs there, and that's typical Tottenham, that. We've had a good spell in the game, but not made it fair, and now we should go on and go on, because that's just what we needed.
Well done to Lad Nemeth there, it has to be said, doesn't it?
It does, but you've got to say the ball through him. I think it was Wiltshire who's put the ball, it's a great ball, but that's great play, that. He'd be disappointed not to score there, but fair play. Christie coming in, what a goal, what a finish.
Well, Wiltshire and Nemeth were two of the changes Steve McLaren made for this game, and well, those changes have paid off immediately, haven't they?
Definitely, absolutely brilliant.
Now it's gone down, surely that's a penalty kick. Well, Perry it is, who's having an absolute nightmare at the moment. He slipped for the previous goal. Now he's brought Nemeth down through clean on goal. And this could be a red card, Jamie.
Yeah, I mean, I hate to say it, and I hate to see people get red cards for that, because it is. I mean, he's the last defender. There's no arguments under the current rules, but it's still disappointing, because, you know, he's made a challenge, although it being clumsy. It's disappointing to see players get a red card for that.
Well, here we see it again. Nemeth is the final man, isn't he? He's the final defender. Well,
I think he's a very unfortunate man there. I mean, you know, just watching that again, as Nemeth goes through.
Looks outside the box to me.
Yeah. He has made contact, but I mean, it's difficult, but hey, we'll take that all day long.
Well, it's a penalty kick. Juninho to take. Oh, Keller saved it, but it's got in now. Hey! Well, how unlucky for Casey Keller. He made the save, the ball stayed on the line. Well, was that Brazilian arrogance or what? This is Juninho again. Juninho's gone inside, head up and Jevcevic. He's had a shot. Oh, it nearly slipped in underneath Keller. Wiltshire with a shot. Now Nemeth. Oh, that's another one. Well, it's 3 in 27 minutes for Middlesbrough. Gerard Nemeth has justified his inclusion in the side. He's run straight over to the bench. It's now 7 goals in 19 starts.
That is unbelievable. You just look there now, you look at the Tottenham players and they're demoralised. That is unbelievable. They've completely just folded. I mean, it's unbelievable to see a professional team just fold in such a way.
Well, Gerard Nemeth, there'd been some press stories about him in the week, from when he was away on international duty, saying he wanted to start more. He's certainly done the right thing today. Had a magnificent hand in the first. Oh, King struggling to control that one. Nemeth it is that's going to play Macaroni, and Flagger stayed down. Macaroni! Oh, it's number 4 for Middlesbrough. And Massimo Macaroni's only been on the pitch 5 minutes. And he's scored his 8th goal of the season. He's leading goal scorer for Borough. Well, we have started the second half much like we ended the first, Jamie.
Yeah, absolutely brilliant. Again, Tottenham all over at the back, taking chances, very sloppy defending, but fair play, Nemeth there, he's won the ball and he's unselfishly, he's put Macaroni in. What a great finish. I mean, that's superb for Macaroni.
Well, if Steve McLaren and the chairman and the chief executive wanted a nice way to send their fans off to the summer, this has certainly been the afternoon for it, hasn't
absolutely
it?
Brilliant. I mean, you talk about wanting a convincing performance at home, this has been brilliant.
This will be one that lifts the fans. Massimo Macaroni there linking up well with Gerard Nemeth. Credit again to the Slovakian, and an excellent finish by the Italian. It's a Tottenham free kick nonetheless, chance for them maybe to restore a certain amount of parity back into the scoreline. King leaves it, comes in, and it's in the top corner. and it's a fantastic goal in the end. Jamie Redknapp has scored the goal that's put Tottenham back up 4-1.
The game you'll see on Borough TV Extra on Monday night at 6:15, of course, if they are to stay in the Premiership next season, so it should be another cracker next week. This is Janino again, ball through to Macaroni. Macaroni has made it 5. Flag has stayed down. There was a couple of anxious looks to the linesman, but it's 5-1. Moonwalking Macaroni as well there.
Yeah, I mean, it's 5-1, and where's it going to end? Is it 6? Is it 7? Is it 8? Tottenham are absolutely shocking.
Massimo Macaroni's 9th goal this season for Middlesbrough.
I mean, that's not taken away from Middlesbrough, because the football Middlesbrough have played, and the quality of the movement and the position and the finishing has been superb.
Well, Massimo Macaroni has scored his 2nd. It'd be great for the Italian to get a hat-trick here this afternoon. And I think while you're seeing the replays of Massimo Macaroni, Steve McLaren's lining up a substitution. I think young Stuart Downing could be getting a bit of a run out in this one. Great, well-taken goal by Massimo.
So bad for Tottenham, I'm sure
you were. Straighting, he just lashed out, I think.
Yeah, I'm sure
the referee thought ball into Macaroni again. Macaroni's toe-poked it just past the post. But I thought the Italian was on for his hat-trick. There's just a minute to be played at the end of this game, a minute of stoppage time. How close was this, Jamie?
Great run, great ball, and he's just poked it there, but just the wrong side of the goal. But again, you've got to say, Tottenham, I've never seen such a poor Premiership outfit.
The curtain fell on season 2002-2003 at the Reebok Stadium, as Bolton Wanderers were fighting for survival, and they would stay in the top flight with a win. But at least Michael Ricketts gave Borough hope of what might come next time around, with his first goal in a red shirt.
And the shot comes in, and it's in the back of the net. And what a fantastic opening goal from Per Frandsen. And that's what Bolton Wanderers wanted. One of two. Whistle is now gone. It is a Kotcher. Oh, and he's put it straight in the back of the net. And Bolton Wanderers have added a second. Riggett, who's in ahead of Ugo Ehiog, who's out with a knee injury, of course. Now a real chance, Parnaby got some space. Ricketts, yes! Michael Ricketts against his old side has pulled one back for Borough. Well, we talked about it, didn't we, Billy? The script was written.
Without doubt, that was the best move of the whole game.
Michael Ricketts has pulled one back, and it's gone very, very quiet around the Reebok Stadium now.
So a season of progress for the Borough, with entertainment back at the Riverside and some thrilling wins over Manchester United, Liverpool and Newcastle, and a final place of 11th with 49 points. Stuart Parnaby picked up the Young Player of the Year award after establishing himself at right back, and Jonathan Greening crowned a terrific season by being named as the Player of the Year and getting an England call-up. New signings have all had a chance to settle in, and with Janino back to full fitness, there's a great deal of optimism that next season, the third of Steve McLaren's reign, might just be the one to produce some silverware. The Riverside, in August 2003, could be a very special place to be.
Hi, I'm Ugo, and you're watching Barrow TV Extra.
Hi, I'm Macarone Massimo. You're watching Barrow TV Extra.
TV.
You're watching Barrow TV Extra.
TV.
I...
Nearly.